us if you're able, and we are going to start by singing "The River Is Here." Our purpose here is to prayerfully build relationships, to impact lives with the transforming power of Jesus Christ, of course, for the growth of God's kingdom. That's what we are about. And we get to start expanding that opportunity next Sunday morning at 9:30. When you come at 9:30, we will have Sunday school classes for all ages, adults included. If you are accustomed to sitting home and having coffee on Sunday morning, you are robbing yourself of growing in the Lord. I just want you to know that. You are. And we have coffee here. So come on and find a class that you enjoy. And if you don't like that one right away, then say, I'm going to try the other one. That's an option you can take. I know it's not something we normally do, but it's an option you can take. And we do have adult-wise. For the children, we're going to start off what's called Space Quest, and that's going to be for the youngest to through sixth grade. Pastor Luke, what's the title of yours? What? Sermon on the Mount. And that's starting with the teens next week at 9:30. And then for the adults, we have the road to the Romans Road or something like that. I don't remember the title of it, but I'll call it the Romans Road, but it's called Following the Road to Rome. And then we have also Truth Project is we're going to unveil that again. And if you want to see some very good reasons why we believe what we believe, the Truth Project is a class that you might want to take. And that is for both guys and gals, as well as the book on Rome or the class in Romans. And there's a men's class, obviously just for men. It's really on the character of men, the second part, The Measure of Man by Gene Getz. And am I missing an adult class, or I think that's it? That's it. Okay, so we've got lots of options. As your pastor, do I want you to be here? Yes. Just for numbers? No. Numbers don't do you any good. It doesn't do me any good other than maybe when I do my annual report at the end of the year. What we want you here for is to grow in your faith, because we're here about prayerfully building relationships. You do that with people. to impact them with the transforming power of Christ. And you do that by how your character and the words and how you carry yourself during the course of the week. And we help you to do that in Sunday school. So we hope that you'll take advantage of that. That begins at 9:30. If you come at 9:30 and you forget, that's okay. Just go to a class, and at 10:45, you'll be here for the worship service. You'll be on time. So we hope that you join us next week. The other announcement I want to share with you, do we have that picture? Did you show that of Doug Fussell? Thank you. Every communion service during the year of 2015, if you haven't been with us, if you're a guest with us, we have declared 2015 as the year of blessing. And so every communion service, we have been taking a special offering for a special purpose. And sometimes we know far ahead of time what that's for. Sometimes we don't. Just last week, there was a funeral for this man, Doug Fussell. His family lives in Virginia. As you can read, they have 9 children, 2 of which are adult children. The rest are still in the home. Teresa is the surviving wife, and unfortunately, he did not have any life insurance. So you can imagine, or maybe you can't, I can't really, what that's going to be like to now make adjustments for that family. And so we are taking an offering today. When you come up to receive the communion elements, if you want to give an offering toward this family, just make the check out to the Hibbing Alliance Church, and you can put it in that basket and put in the memo, Doug. That's all you have to put in, okay? And then we'll make sure that the family gets those gifts of blessing from us. And so as we go to prayer, I'm going to ask Pastor Luke to come up and pray. And pray for the Fussells as well as anything else God's laid in your heart.
Thank you. Let's pray. Father God, I am so thankful for the opportunity to once again come as a family and worship your name. Thank you for the gifts that you have given us. Thank you for this free country where we can praise your name without fear. Pray for the leaders of our country in that you would give them wisdom into the right way, the truth way. Lord God, I pray for the opposition that there is right now in this country to freely express our beliefs and our convictions. Pray that we move once again towards a freedom that there is no fear. Father, I am grateful that you are our comforter. You come beside us when we're hurting. And I pray especially for the Fussell family with this loss. Pray that in these hard times that your presence would be undeniable and that your goodness would reign supreme. I'm thankful that in Christ our family is enormous, and that as brothers and sisters we can come beside each other the way that you come beside us, to give gifts, to offer comfort. Pray that as they move into this season of mourning that we become good comforters for each other. Lord God, I pray for this service that you would be blessed by our singing, by the ministry of the word, and the ministry of the table. Pray that as we receive the gifts that you have for us, your bread, your body and your blood, that we receive it and we take it in, and that in doing so, we begin to live out the life that Christ lived out. Give you praise and the glory, for you are the worthy one. You are the river of life that sustains us. We give you all the praise and the glory. Amen.
Poured out to death many times.
what that last line said. You look at my heart. You know who I am and what I am about. And sometimes the things that I do that are bad, and yet you still love me. You know me by name. God, we thank you for that kind of personal love. I pray as we go through the message today, God, that if there's anyone here or that listens when it's on the television, God, that doesn't understand what it means to have a personal love with God, a personal relationship. It's not about churches, Lord. It's not about religion. It's about that identification of being placed in the family of God. So I pray, God, that you will speak to our hearts today about what we need to hear as we launch on this adventure series, the adventures of being in God. Thank you, Father, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. As we get started with the message, I have a clip. It's a little dated, but it has a great theme that we're going into, so please enjoy. If you are in children's church, you are invited to go to your own service at this moment.
Saddle up your horses. Time.
offering it, but the purpose of that song is we are going to start a series this morning, and it is going to take on different parts along the way, but the whole series is going from now until the end of the year, and it will be on Adventure Series. The adventure begins today. I wanted you to hear this song because it's the first thing that came to mind. I'm sitting down, okay, we're going to do the Adventures series, and we're going to talk about the adventure of being in Christ and the adventure of serving Christ and these kind of things. Boy, how do you get an adventure going? And when I thought about this and then YouTubed it, it's like, yeah, that's what an adventure is supposed to be. Saddle up your horses, man. We are going out, and we're going to have a great time on this adventure together. And an adventure is something you just don't hear about. An adventure is something you actually engage in. Let me give you an example. Back in 1995, again, dating myself, but when our children were younger, Micah wasn't even born yet, we decided that we were going to take a trip to Disney World. This would be a major trip, going to be like a week long. It was going to be our first time that we really did this as a family, and it was like, well, this was going to be exciting. So we didn't just say, okay, we're going to Disney World, and we didn't just sit on, you know, find out the airline tickets, and then we included the kids. We went over and we got these books from the library called Bird Bond's Book of Disney World, and it has maps of all the different Disney locations in Disney World. You can go to Wild Kingdom, and you can go, there was no Animal Kingdom back then, but there was the Epcot Center, and there was MGM Studios, which is now Disney movie thingies, whatever, but we plotted with the kids. We sat down and we looked at, okay, here's the Magic Kingdom. This is where all the major rides are. According to the book, the latest edition from Birnbaum's book of Disney World, it says if you start here when you come in the entrance at 9 o'clock in the morning and then you take this path over here, you can go bing, bing, bing and hit the three major rides before the big crowd show up. And the kids are all excited, and they're engaging in this planning for this adventure. We didn't go. No, I'm kidding. Of course we went. The adventure isn't planning. The adventure is actually engaging in what you plan for, right? The anticipation was built up among our children. And then it was, we get to go. And so we went, and we had a great, great time. Micah was there. That was a point where Darcy was pregnant. And so we brought him with. He just didn't get to enjoy it the way the rest of us did. But a great adventure, part of it is in preparing for it, but it never is fully realized until you engage in it. And this is what we're talking about. The adventure of serving Christ, the adventure of being a believer, is not just talking about it. It's not just reading about it. It's not just studying about it. It's engaging in that adventure. And so that's what this series is going to be about. It is the title of the series actually came from the children's Sunday school class, because they've got three segments that they'll be following through the end of 2015, I believe. One is the Space Quest. That's the first adventure. Another one is the Wilderness Trail. And I forget what the third one is. Anybody know? It's on the bulletin board. You can find it out. Okay, but there are these adventures that are happening with the kids. And there's the adventures that are happening with the teens. The Sermon on the Mount, that is a huge adventure. If you haven't read the Sermon on the Mount, if you haven't heard the teaching and the environment that was going on at that moment, that is an incredible adventure. If you were the people that were there at that moment in time, it was phenomenal. And the teens are going to be looking at that. And for the adults, we have different adventure opportunities, different roads you can take, if you will, to discover what God has for us, to discover what it means to be a part of this family of God and how we can engage in serving God most effectively. So today we launch our new adventure series. And through the remainder of 2015, let me just say this, we are going to end the adventure series with a intentional outreach ministry. It's going to start with the Advent theme. The Advent theme this year is going to be, and it starts the last Sunday in November, the Adventures of Christmas. And each Sunday, we are going to use some of the traditional Christmas themes so that we can invite people in. You know what our church is doing? We're going to look at, why is there a Christmas tree? Why are there Christmas lights? Why are there greeting cards and all these kind of things? We're going to use that as the means of talking about Christmas, but then, of course, unveiling what the real meaning of Christmas is all about. And that's going to be an adventure, starting with the Advent on November 28th, I believe it is. And then it ends on Christmas Eve. That's the fifth of the Advent, five Advent days. On that day, we are going to have what's called the Legend of the Candy Cane, according to the gal that wrote the book that I'm going to be using. And that legend is talking about, tells this story about this guy that comes to a town in the Old West, or kind of in the Old West, and he starts a candy store, and he goes out and he hands out invitations, candy canes, to come to the store for the grand opening. So we're going to play off of that theme, and we're going to have the Legend of the Candy Cane book available to every family that comes on Christmas Eve. Prior to that, we're going to ask our congregational members to go out. We will provide you with the materials, but to go out with an invitation card that has a candy cane on it, and you will personally invite your neighbors, your family, your friends, whoever you want, and say, come to Christmas Eve. It's going to be a great service. We're going to talk about the candy cane story. And if you don't know the Legend of the Candy Cane, it has a gospel message to it, and of course, we're going to then invite people to understand what Jesus did for all of us. This is the adventure we're on from now until the end of the year. So join us, keep coming back for the great adventure. First, we need to review to make sure we've had all that we need for the trip. That's part of going on an adventure, is that you pack. And we've been unpacking and packing, if you will, for this great adventure. In the last few weeks, we have talked about what it means to be an Acts 1:8 Christ-centered church. That includes four important elements: love to proclaim, the love of God to proclaim God, to reach people in God for God, and to launch and actually do the ministry. Acts 1:8 says, the Holy Spirit, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. This is for all those who have followers of Christ. And I need to really emphasize this, because if there's anything I see in the modern day Christian world, at least in our Western civilization, is that we have lost what it is to walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. We claim the salvation of Christ, but we don't see the transformation. Remember the reason why we exist? Prayerfully building relationships so that we have the right to introduce Christ, but the transforming power of Christ for the growth of God's kingdom. The transforming power of Christ. If a person has received Christ, if they go, yes, okay, I want that fire insurance. I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. So Jesus, I pray. If I have to pray to receive you as my Savior so I don't go to hell, then I pray that. But there's no change in their life. There's no transformation from the things that were once darkness to now things that are light. Then there's no salvation. Salvation is evidenced by the transformation. And we don't tell people about Christ so that they'll join this church, although we invite them to do that. We don't tell people about Christ so that they join some Christian religion, although obviously we're inviting them to be a part of that. We tell them about Christ because every person is born separated from God because of sin in our lives that we're born with. And unless that sin factor is removed, we are continuously lost and separated from God. And if we die in that sin, it says the wages of sin is death, separation for all eternity. So the adventure that all believers have is to, first of all, we know, as if we're believers, we know what it is to be transformed. And we know there's a responsibility with that salvation and transformation. And so now the adventure is I get to go out and help others discover the joy of salvation, to know what it is to be transformed by Christ, to know what it is to become a disciple of Christ, to know what it is to look forward to Christ's return and not live in fear that he might. This is the great adventure. We will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon us, and then we will be his witnesses in Jerusalem, our local town, Judea, Samaria, and the othermost parts of the earth. We will take on that role and responsibility and say, yes, Lord, I want that adventure. I want to saddle up my horse and I want to ride, because that's what you built me and called me to do. We also talked about prior to that about healthy disciple-making church. And that's what we want to be. We don't want to be a church that just wins converts and notches the gun of salvation people who come into Christ, but rather we want to help them to build them as a healthy disciple so they in turn reach people for Christ and build them as healthy disciples. And that's how God says we're going to populate the earth with followers of Christ. We do that through the process of winning people to Christ, building people up in their faith, equipping them for service, and then multiplying them by seeing them bring others to Christ and sending them out to do the process again and again and again. It's not a process, by the way, where, for instance, if I was the one doing it, that I would find someone and I would build a relationship with them and I would receive the joy of seeing them come to Christ, and then I work with them that they might grow in their faith and understand what their spiritual gifts are, and they might get out and start doing the same thing that we just did, and then they go out and win someone to Christ and they start building someone up in their faith. I don't get a pass at that point and go, I did my job. There's old Joe and he's doing his thing and hallelujah, I did my job. My job is when I get this person going on their own, then I'm working with this person and I'm working this person, because then you've got two people and now four people and now eight people and it grows. That's the way God designed the church to grow, his church. If these core actions do not get to the heart, however, they will not get to the other extremities. You will remember, and I don't know if that picture is, do we have that picture now? That one with the little guy? Yeah, there. You remember when we did this? This was a number of weeks ago. But this is what a balanced, healthy, balanced diet for a human body is that we have fruits and vegetables, and that, you know, it's up in the head area. And you over here, you got, you're eating enough fats, but not too much fats. And you're eating dairy, but not too much dairy. You're eating meats, you're eating grains, and you're eating all the proper food groups. You're doing it all in the proper way. We could add exercise in there if you want. That's the hardest part, I think, sometimes. And that's what a healthy diet would look like for the human body to be able to function the way God designed the human body to function in a healthy fashion. Well, using that as a picture story, we go on to the next one, and this is the balanced spiritual diet of a healthy disciple. And those food groups are winning people to Christ, salvation. That's one of the food groups. And then there's the building people in their faith, understanding what the Scripture says about how God wants us to live, Bible knowledge and application, Bible memory, healthy relationships, worship, prayer, devotional life, spiritual fullness. That's a part of, that's a main diet, by the way. Most Christian churches, at least in this country, they're focused, we're focused on that. Okay? And that's good, but when you only eat one style of food too often, it'll throw off your healthy body. So we're also needing equipping. That's spiritual gifts, talent, skills, outreach, stewardship. That's about the equipping the body for service and then multiplying and sending. Christian service, mission involvement. It takes for a congregation, but this is also true for an individual, to have a healthy spiritual diet. It takes all those things in play, not just one or two of those things. So consequently, we are right now in the process, our teams are set, and you're going to be contacted if you're a leader of any department or ministry in the church, and they're going to interview you. And we're going to try to discover what each ministry focuses on. What's the primary focus? Even though there may be elements of some of these other things, what's the number one thing that's consistent in that ministry? Because then we're going to find out just how healthy or unhealthy are we as a congregation and the ministries and the opportunities we provide for our people. And of course, once we discover that, and if we feel that we're out of balance in our diet, then we've got to change our diet so that we live and we produce healthy disciples. And that's true in our own life as well. Having a personal quiet time with God is so important. That's the building aspect in a person's life. But then we also need to seek God. That's why we provide Sunday school, by the way, to equip people. And worship service, to build them up and to equip them, to challenge us to win people to Christ, as well as to send them out and say, okay, this is what you have. So go and do it for the glory of God. But again, if these core actions do not get to the heart, if they don't if we haven't embraced them, then they're not going to happen out in the extremities. We're not going to win people for Christ. We're not going to build. If there truly is not a heart passion for Christ, these things will not get accomplished. I want to share with you a scripture from the book of Matthew, the story of the sower. I'm going to read this for you, and then we'll go through some of the elements. I'll just from Matthew 13. And it's not in its entirety. I did take some verses out for brevity, but the story about the sower is intact. And he spoke many things to them, Jesus that is, in parables, saying, "Behold, the sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell beside the road, and the birds came and ate them up. Others fell on the rocky places where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up because they had no depth of soil. But when the sun had risen, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. Others fell among the thorns, and the thorns came up and choked them out. And others fell on the good soil and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Well, he who has an ear, let him hear." And the disciples came to said to him, "Why do you speak to these people in parables?" And Jesus answered them, "To you it has been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been granted. For whoever has, to him more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has, shall be taken away from him." Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sowed in his heart. This is the one on whom seed was sown beside the road. The one on whom seed was sown on the rocky places, this is the man who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no firm root in himself, but is only temporary. And when affliction of persecution arises because of the word, immediately he falls away. And the one on whom seed was sown among the thorns, this is the man who hears the word, and the worry of the world and the deceitfulness of the wealth choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. And on the one of whom the seed was sown on the good soil, this is the man who hears the word, understands it, who indeed bears fruit and brings forth some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. Now let me ask you, who was on the great adventure there? Who embraced it? Who had this heart passion to encompass all that was provided an opportunity for an adventure? It was the one in the good soil, wasn't it? We have many people that will pray to receive Christ because they don't want to go to hell. But they don't embrace Christ. Therefore, their life doesn't show any difference, any transformation. And then when hardship comes, some of them shake their fist at God and blame him for the hardship rather than embracing him and helping and asking him to walk with him or her through that hardship. The one thing that really impresses me about this is the sower sows seeds everywhere. He doesn't sit there and try to evaluate which is the best seed or the best ground, I mean. He doesn't look at the thorns and go, "I'm not sure it's going to take there. I'm going to skip that." He doesn't look at the rocky path. What he does is he is faithful. The sower has the message of growth and of life and of hope, which we know is Jesus Christ. And he sows it. He throws it out there, hoping that it will take for every single person that hears the word of God. But in this picture story, not everybody embraces that message. We do have a free will, and we can, in our free will, say no to God. I don't want the responsibility. I don't want to change my life. I like the way what I'm doing and how I'm doing it. And so I'll embrace the love of God. That's great. God is love. I'll take that. But then the sun comes out or the thorns start choking. And suddenly that relationship that we thought was there doesn't exist. It's only those with the good soil that say, you know what, I'm going to let that get deep. Those roots are going to get deep. It's going to be a part of who I am. It's how I'm going to live my life. And I'm not going to just stop at a certain level, but I am going to go on that great adventure. I'm going to saddle up my horse, and I'm going to go out and do the things that God's called me to do and use the gifts he's given me and the talents and the skills, not just to create something that is enjoyable to me, but rather to fulfill the goal that God has given me in my life to be a witness for him under the power of his Holy Spirit. The results are God's. That's what verse 8 says. And others fell on good soil and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. You know, we might not all have the same success, if I can use this success rate, in how we reach people for Christ. We may all be out there throwing out equally, sowing equally in this picture story, but we may not all receive equally what we see happen. I look at, remember when Joel and Marie Howard, what we had here a few weeks ago, missionaries in Mali for years and years and years, they were there, they were in that country serving God in a country that was predominantly Muslim for 15 years, and in 15 years they never saw one person bow their knee to Jesus Christ. 15 years. You think that could be discouraging? Do you think they quit sowing the seed like, it's not working, it's falling on the rocky ground? No, they remained tenacious in serving Christ because they knew that this was the calling, that the results were God's, but the calling was theirs. I remember when I was in Duluth, a woman there talked about the fact that she had a husband that was an alcoholic and he did not want to follow Christ, and she prayed for him, I think it was 35 or 37 years. Stayed with him and prayed for him through all the abuse of alcoholism. She stayed with him and prayed for him because she knew the calling God had placed on her life. And the year that he died, prior to his death, of course, he prayed to receive Christ. And she said that year was the most blessed year of our marriage in all the years that we've been married. We are called to do different things and to serve God in different ways, but we are all called to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to be from the power on high, to be his witnesses, whether it be here in Hibbing, whether it be to our families or to our friends or our co-workers. And that witness is both verbal and according to how we carry ourselves. Because how easy is it to be at work and there's everybody around the water cooler or at this meeting or whatever it is, and they're all ragging against the establishment or all ragging against the job or whatever it is, and we are believers and we're to be believers that say, I appreciate so much that God has given me my life. But instead, we go, those rats, yeah. Or that coworker, that cubicle, that person I got to serve a cubicle with, they are so rotten. I can't stand being there. You tell me if that sounds like a Christ-like person. We are to be witnesses. We are to be witnesses that stand up for Christ and say, I'm so happy about my faith because he gives me peace and contentment in the midst of the worst situations I might be in. The results are God's. The surrendered are blessed with understanding. This is the unique thing. When the disciples came to Jesus, they didn't say, Jesus, we don't understand what you're talking about. You keep talking in riddles. They didn't say that. They said, why do you tell them parables? He didn't say, why do you tell us? Because he said, you understand these things. Those who are surrendered and blessed are with understanding. When a person comes to faith in Christ, it is because the Holy Spirit reveals truth to them so that now they can understand and make a decision about whether or not they want to surrender to Christ and follow him or not. I praise God for those of you that are here that are truly surrendered and blessed because you have that understanding. As a matter of fact, if sometime during this series you feel like, the pastor was really hard on us today, stepping on our toes, probably isn't the pastor, it's probably the Holy Spirit using the pastor, and that's because you have understanding. And it's like, okay, what am I going to do with this? Because this makes me uncomfortable because I really don't want to go there. But yet, that's why he's given us his power and his person for his purpose. The disciples, or the disciple, disciples. Verse 23, and the one who on whom seed was sown on the good soil, this is the man who hears the word, understands it, and indeed bears fruit. The disciple, disciples. This is that adventure we're talking about. To being a disciple, but being a healthy disciple. See, we use that term in the church a lot. Let's go make disciples. Well, what does that mean? Well, that means a lot of work, to tell you the truth. It means a lot of sacrifice. It means giving up some of your comforts and my comforts in order to help someone else grow into the kind of person God wants them to be so that they can go reach people for Christ and disciple those people as well. It's a perpetual job that God has given to all believers, and when we die, then we are blessed with a promotion. But until death, we are disciple makers. God's words, not mine. And you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit, and you'll be my witnesses. And he talks about sowing that seed and putting it out there. I was talking with a friend of mine. Actually, some of you remember him, Bob and Patty Aspling. Bob is in the hospital. They've preached here a couple times together when I've been gone. And Bob that's a long story, but he had a knee put in. It was infected. Unfortunately, the VA isn't doing the job it should be doing in the last few days. And so for 8 years, he had a low-grade infection in that knee until finally a doctor who was not in the VA discovered what the problem was and had it taken out. So he's in the hospital, and then he has this problem with this high ammonia situation because his liver or kidneys aren't functioning properly, and he's in a bad way. And so when I'm there visiting him, he's kind of sitting there and saying, I don't know why this wasn't discovered sooner, and I don't know why I'm in the hospital, but if this is where God wants me to be right now, then he wants me to do something here. Huh? Not, woe is me, God, get me out of here, although that's what he wants. But Lord, if my sickness is here for a reason, then I will use that reason for your glory. None of us want to be sick. Unfortunately, the curse of sin allows for sickness and death to be upon everyone. Even though God is a healer, and we believe that he can heal people, and we pray that he does, and he does heal many people, eventually everybody dies. Except for two. That was Enoch and Elijah. Okay? Eventually, everybody is going to die. It's just that sometimes we're prepared for it, and sometimes we're not. Sometimes we anticipate it because someone's getting elderly, and sometimes we feel it's grossly unfair because they're too young. Like Doug Fussell. But our strength is in Christ. Our hope is in Christ. This earth is only temporary. And praise be to God, God has empowered us to overcome the curse of sin and death with eternal life. And that comes when we surrender ourselves to Christ and repent and turn from our sins and say, God, I will follow you always. The other thing is the disciple wins, builds, equips, multiplies, sends. Some 100-fold, some 60, some 30, but they are involved in the process. And that's what God wants for each and every one of us who sits here this morning and says that we are a follower of Christ, is that we are his disciple, that we will win and build and equip and multiply and send others into the field. And as we do that, we grow in ourselves in that regard. So as we set off on this journey, we will encounter these adventures together from different perspectives. But we will learn what is a good way in which to accomplish this, and what are the tools that I have in front of me. And we've talked about some of those, but we're going to provide more to you in the process. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. We're going to have communion together. But how does communion fit into this? Because it does. When Jesus gave the elements of the bread and the cup, he talked about the fact that the bread represents my body, which was broken for you. And what he meant by that is the body that was whipped, the body that was had thorns put on his head, the body that was spit upon and was slugged and beaten and cursed. He said, my body was broken for you. We know in Isaiah it says that it is through his stripes, through his scourging, that we can anticipate healing, not only the healing from sin to salvation, but the divine healing of the body, that the curse of the sickness on the body as a result of the curse of sin can be removed by God. And he's chosen many times to do that. We don't know who he's going to say, yes, this is, or no, this isn't at this time. But we do know he says, come unto me, all who are burdened and heavy laden. He says, pray for those who are sick, that they will be healed. And he responds to the faith and the prayers of people as we step out and say, I'm going to position myself for that which God wants me to have. It could very well be a divine healing. When we do not position ourselves for that, chances are you aren't going to receive it, because there's no faith involved when we step away from that positioning. So the body is there, broken and bruised for our sin, for our iniquity. And also the cup represents the blood of Christ that was the only payment that would be acceptable to the Father, was the blood of the Son, that had no sin issue in it whatsoever, that was poured out for our salvation, paid the ransom that kept us in prison of sin. And Jesus said, I'll pay that ransom for you with my life and my blood. Your sins can be removed if you will pray Jesus removes them. And in the process, surrender to Jesus and say, now you are my Savior and my Lord, and I'm going to follow you and do it your way the rest of my life. So we come to the table to remember the joy of salvation and the commitment that Jesus made for us and that we in turn are making for him. Because this is the year of blessing, when you come up, if you want to contribute to the Facel family a gift of blessing through finances, then just put it in the basket here and we'll make sure that that family receives those offerings. The scripture says when you come to the table of the Lord that we're supposed to examine ourselves first, so that we don't take on the guilt of the body and the blood of the Lord. In other words, the same association that of those people that called for the death of Christ. Because we don't want to just do this as a religious function, but rather as a personal response in obedience and love to Christ to commemorate and remember what he did for us. So we're going to just have a moment of prayer, so that you can take a moment to pray. I'm going to maybe ask Renee, and I thank Renee for being here to play today, if you can just start playing our song while people reflect, and then I will give you instruction when it's time to receive the elements. Let's just take some time to pray together. As Renee continues to play and we are in a prayer mode, I feel that I should be asking the question. You've heard what it is to really be in love with Jesus, is to recant, if you will, of your sins and say, I'm not going there anymore. But rather, Jesus, I ask you to forgive me, and I embrace you as my Savior, and I surrender to you. I will follow you according to the Word of God. I will follow you however you lead me. And if there's someone here this morning that has never done that, has never made that commitment, but wants to make that commitment right now, I'm just going to ask you to raise your hand so I can pray over you. I won't embarrass you, but this is your opportunity to say, yes, Lord, I want Jesus to be my Savior. Is there anyone here this morning that desires to receive Christ for themselves? Just raise your hand at this time. Okay, thank you. Anyone else? I'm not talking about recommitting your life to Christ, although you may feel you need to do that, and I encourage you to do that this morning. But I'm talking to someone that has never prayed to receive Christ. And it's like, I know that's what I'm supposed to be doing right now. And maybe your heart's fluttering and you're feeling almost like a panic attack. And you're going, I don't know what's happening here. It is the Spirit of God saying, I want you to be free from your sin and to be part of the family of God. If you want to embrace that today and receive that for yourself, now's your opportunity. Just raise your hand and I'll pray for you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for this message of salvation. And Lord, the communion table is really to bring us to recommitment and dedication, because you call us to examine ourselves and seek for us to confess any sins that maybe we've allowed into our life and embraced, that we can ask you to forgive us again of that. So Lord, as we come to the table, bring that fresh awareness of the joy of our salvation and the fresh awareness of the commitment that we've made to you as a believer, that we are on a great adventure. And some of us, Lord, have let the horse be in the stall too long. It's time to saddle up and getting in the game. So Lord, I just pray now that your Spirit be upon us and that you give us a sense of awe and celebration as we receive the bread and the cup of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray in your name. Amen. As we sing the song, I'm going to encourage you to do two things. Number one, come up, of course, and receive the elements and take it back to your seat. And when you feel you're ready to take the bread and drink the cup, you do so on your timetable. I encourage you to be a fellowship or family of God. It'd be great to do it with somebody. So if you don't have a family here, just move to the person closest to you and say, can we eat and drink together? If you have a family, just use immediate family. You can use a large group, small group. Just understand why we are taking the elements. And of course, if you want to give a gift, leave it here as you retrieve your elements. And then if you desire prayer for divine healing, and I do believe that God is a healer of the body, and you want us to pray over you according to the book of James chapter 5, it says, if you're sick, call for the elders of the church, confess your sins, and pray for one another, the prayer of faith, that you may be healed, that you will be healed. And so in my room back there, just in the back of the sanctuary, if you would like prayer, just walk back there, and I'm going to have some elders and some deaconesses back there ready to receive you and to pray over you and anoint you with oil according to the book of James, and leave the results to God. Let's stand together as we sing, and when you're ready to come get the elements, come and receive them in the name of Jesus.
Worthy is the Lamb who was
Everything. And I thank you so much. I thank you for our salvation. I thank you that while we were still in our sins, you didn't wait till we got good enough until we finally acknowledged you. But while we were still sinners, Christ, you died for us. Help us now, God, in our salvation to live for you. To be one that makes healthy disciples, to be one that accepts the call and the challenge to go into all the world and preach the gospel, to use the power and the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ to be your witnesses at home and abroad. Father, empower us. Allow us, Lord, to feel that in our hearts, to have that compassion, Lord. We've been in the planning stage for many, many years, some for many years. We have set the course. Now, Lord, it's to actually do the adventure. And so, Father, I pray that we go out from here and we determine that this week that we will help someone grow in their faith. We will help someone discover the joy of salvation. That, Lord, that we will not sit back and look back and see, oh, did we have 100-fold or 30-fold or 1-fold? We won't be worried about that. We will just cast and throw the seeds of hope and salvation and allow the Spirit of God to move in people's lives. But God, use us. And I pray that we, God, allow you to use us for your glory in this great adventure. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you have not yet asked for prayer and you would like to do so, then you're still welcome to go in the office as you, instead of going out that way, go out that way, and people will pray over you, and we'll pray and believe by faith for a divine healing. Thank you for coming. Hope you join us next Sunday morning, 9:30 for Sunday school, 10:45 for worship. Go in God's peace.
Choir practice starts this Wednesday night. We'd love to have you join us.